Good afternoon. I'm City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge, and this is the Committee on Social Services, Veterans, Culture, and Recreation. I would like to introduce City Councilor Gina Louise Shiera from Ward 4, and I'm City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge from Ward 6 in the chair. And Alyssa Klein will be here. She's a councilor from Ward 7. And she's coming through some traffic over the Hadley Bridge, so it's going to take her about 10 minutes or so to get here. But I would like to go ahead and call the meeting to order. And I also would like to announce the meeting that is being audio and video recorded by NCTV. I would like to make a motion for the approval of the minutes of April 22nd.
Move to approve.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, Mark. I'll have you come right up so we can get you out for 4:30. I would like to introduce Mark Guglielmo. Director of Operations, Young at Heart Chorus. And thank you, Mark, for being here. This is the first time that we've ever had Young at Heart's Chorus since we've added cultural recreation onto this committee. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I think it's cool, and sometimes I think it's a lot trying to get all the arts, whatever we can do to fulfill, to show the visibility here in the city. So why don't you tell us all about the Young Heart, tell us about your position, what you do, and your expectations.
Expectations in terms of?
Of the city.
Of the city. So Young Heart, for all who don't know, started in 1982. It started as a sing-along, and right down in the Walter Salvo House. Bob was, I guess, serving meals. He was working at a meal site for the elderly. And I guess after he served the meal, he asked a woman he worked with if she wanted to play some songs while they were waiting around. And she knew how to play the piano. Drawing a blank on her.
I'm Elisa.
I'm Mark. Nice to meet you.
I told you you were coming in.
Sorry.
So it started as just a sing-along, and, you know, what, 33 years later, now it's something slightly different. It's still a sing-along. The core of our organization is Monday and Thursday rehearsals for 2 hours, 10 a.m. to noon. Mondays with a piano player right now, and on Thursdays with a full 5-piece band, drums, guitar, bass, clarinet, piano. So I think something important to know about Young Heart is that it's not a social service organization, it's an arts organization. So we don't do a lot of the things that a social service organization would and can do in terms of taking care of people. The taking care that we do is the singing, you know, is the joy, the sort of community that the members get out of being a part of it, being involved in something creative at the end of one's life. We can see in so many people, there's a lot of research being done right now about kind of the effects of singing on the elderly with Alzheimer's, and just what it means to be engaged in something that challenges you emotionally, physically, spiritually, mentally, at that period in our lives is something that not a lot of elderly have. So it's really the core of our mission is to make great art with people who aren't artists. You know, very few of these people none of them have any professional experience. A lot of them sing in church, or may have sung in their family, a lot of them have sung outside of, have sung in some organized fashion, but nothing professional that I know of. And that's what Bob's unique ability is he's able to take kind of regular people and put them in, present them in a way that allows their humanity to be seen. Where in our society, the elderly are kind of pushed to the side in terms of what we look at. If you watch TV or listen to the radio, you're just not going to see the elderly, mm-hmm. you know? So there's something amazing when you go to a Young at Heart show, and I don't know if you guys have, is that you're,
oh, yes.
Okay, good. You know, what strikes me every time is to see the kind of lived experience of these regular people on display without any filter. A lot of people, when they're professionals or they're like see themselves as artists, there's a persona that we kind of can adopt for a certain, we show a certain aspect of ourselves. These people are just so genuine, they're just themselves up there. It's, that humanity just comes through.
Are there, how many do you have in the group?
You know, it varies. Somewhere around 35, I would say, right
That's
now.
Quite a bit.
Actually singing. But there are, you know, people cycle in and cycle out. People haven't sung with us for a couple of years, and they might come back and sing for a couple of weeks or for one show. But a regular, recurring, kind of twice a week, probably about 30 to 35.
So your practicing is twice a week?
Yeah.
So it's not mandatory, though?
If you don't come to rehearsal, you won't be seriously considered for performances.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this is a serious art project. It's not like, la 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 la. No, it's serious. You know, you gotta know the lyrics. We watch. I mean, if people don't know the lyrics, you can't have somebody on stage like everyone's singing and their mouth is closed. That looks horrible. It looks like they didn't do the homework. So it is, it's a big time commitment. And the other interesting thing is that the songs are constantly changing. It's not like they have 20 songs and that's just what they do. Every 6 months, there's 20 new songs or 30 new songs. Every week, they're working on new songs and new songs and new songs. And the ones that are really powerful, they stick, you know? And then you do them for a while, and usually when someone passes away or is no longer in the group, that song kind of goes with them. Sometimes we bring a song back.
Oh, really?
But a lot of times you don't.
There was one person, she was elderly, she could have been in her late 90s or so, and she did a skit at the Academy of Music. Us girls couldn't believe it. I think it was like she was rocking it. And these boots are
made for walking?
Yes, and you should have seen her dancing.
Was this, how long ago was this? 20 years?
Quite a while. No, not 20 years.
No? She was 90?
I bet you now she would
oh,
be.
Oh, now she's 90.
But she could swing it.
There's some good dancers. Yeah. We just got some good dancers that dance seriously.
And now they've upped the age now, correct?
Yeah, that happened, at least 5 to 10 years ago.
Up till what?
73. The minimum age.
What's the audition process again?
Yeah, there isn't really a formal audition process. Usually, it's not always, when someone new shows up, Bob will invite them to sing something, you know? Sometimes they don't, sometimes they keep coming and then they get asked to sing. But it's not like if they do a great job, they're in or they're not.
So it's not really a competitive process. It's if you want to be a part of it and are willing, can make that commitment and show that you're committed.
You can definitely become a part of it. It's what part that is really is determined by kind of commitment. Talent is a part of it, but a lot of people have something else to offer that's not singing talent. They're really interesting to watch on stage, or they dance, or there's some other thing that they offer. There's this one woman in the group now who, you just look at her on stage, she's 90 now, and just when you see the way she stands, you can't take your eyes off her. She's like a tree. She's like rooted to the ground. It's really impressive, and it's something to look at. There's a theatrical element to what we do that it's as if everyone kind of find with kind of Bob, the overseeing eye, finds their place. Some people just can come to rehearsals, but they won't perform live with us. There's all levels of involvement.
What, okay, is there a cost for somebody 73 and over to be able to be part of this organization? I mean, who pays for their trips? Like they went to Japan 1 year and all that, that's costly.
Yeah, the people who bring us pay.
Oh.
They pay part of it, you know. Promoters who have us perform pay for a lot of the costs.
That's a blessing.
Yeah, it's a blessing when they're there to pay, but you know, with the popularity of the film, there were a lot of those people. Now, there aren't those people. So we're kind of back to where we were before the film, where we have to generate interest and gigs, and we have to generate excitement about the group. And, you know, in terms of the actual running of the organization, the rent, the utilities, my salary, Bob's salary, all the musicians' salaries, that's something that we have to raise our own money for. You know, we don't have anyone helping us with that.
So, like, say with advertising, like us counselors received an email in regards to we would like to go ahead,
yeah,
and place an advertisement for the Young at Hearts. That is part of that, of what's used for?
Yes. In the beginning, Young at Heart was basically like a volunteer organization.
Right.
You know, Bob didn't make a salary. The people who did the administrative stuff didn't make a salary. The musicians didn't get paid. It was a very just kind of community organization, just, whatever, let's just make some music, it's fun. But now it's a real professional thing. You know, the musicians that play with us, they're great. I mean, they're the top 1%.
Where did they come from?
They're all from this area. This area has tremendous talent, music-wise and art-wise. But all of them are, some of them have other jobs, but a lot of them don't. They're full-time musicians, and they're all scraping together a living.
I was just going to say, they must be suffering.
It's not easy.
Uh-huh.
And they do suffer, and it's a sacrifice, you know? So there's sort of this invisible element to the organization that even the singers in the group that have no idea. They just, the red carpet rolls out, they show up, the microphone is on, the lights are on, they sing their song, they go, they get applause, everyone stands, they get a standing ovation, and they go home. They have no idea what it really takes to put on that show, to make sure that the whole organization is moving forward, that we have paper to put the lyrics on, that someone typed those up, that the musicians got paid, that we have insurance, that we have these deals with the TV, with newspaper, with radio, that we're approving ads and doing posters, hanging them up all over the street and selling 300 ads to raise money, getting sponsors, pitching the banks. And, you know, the April, we used to, this past year, we do a big event in April where we have an April Fool's show, usually at the Academy, and then we do an intergenerational concert, usually at John and Green Hall, and those were both in April. We're not going to do them both in the same month anymore. We're probably going to do the April Fool's show, and then we'll do something in the fall.
Does that hurt you, like money-wise?
It's just two shows in 1 month. We realize it's
too much.
Yeah, it's too much. We used to not even do benefits for ourselves. We used to only do benefits for other organizations. So we would make a lot of money for local organizations like the Survival Center. God, you name it, we've done it. So we would perform for free, and they would get all the money from the concert. But now, we used to have offices in Memorial Hall, but the city took that away from us. And so now we pay for space in Florence.
Why did the city get away from you?
We were not a city organization, and I don't know the exact reason. I know we got a letter from kind of a legal standpoint, I think it was a little dicey that we were getting some kind of benefits and there are other organizations that have needs that weren't. think it was also that Bob had a dual role.
I got you.
But we do have a higher overhead now. So.
And I bet you couldn't find a spot in Northampton to rent some.
We looked, and there wasn't a spot that worked well, just aesthetically, space-wise. The prices were higher than we wanted to pay, so we were able to find something nice in Florence.
In Florence.
Yeah. But the other aspect of Young at Heart that a lot of people don't know about is that we do partnerships with lots of local organizations, and it's been a history of the group to collaborate, take the elderly and make some music with some other group. And recently we've been doing it with the incarcerated. So last year we launched a fundraising campaign to raise money to pay for this. And the goal was in 2006, the group went to perform a free concert for the inmates at Hampshire County House of Correction. And so Bob had this idea of, let's go back, but let's do it differently. And the idea was, instead of just performing for the inmates, let's actually make music with the inmates and then do a concert when we feel like they're ready with inmates and Young at Heart for the rest of the prison population. So we were able to raise, around $70,000 in about 6 months.
That's excellent.
Yeah. About 42 of it came directly from a Kickstarter campaign. About 30 of it from Kickstarter people and 12 from people who found out, the two foundations who found out about the project through the Kickstarter campaign. And we started in October of last year, and we go into two prisons. We go into the Hampshire County, which is an all-males institution, and we go to Chicopee Women's Prison. And it's 1 hour for a week, once a week for 1 hour. And in May, we had our concert at the Hampshire County House of Friendships, and it was just amazing.
So there's a lot of talent in these.
There is a lot of talent. There's a lot of talent.
What's sort of the basis of, you know, the organization, that there's talent everywhere?
Yeah. You know, it's interesting though, because it's not the talent. The talent blows you away when you see it. But more than the talent, it's the lives that are being changed. You know, when we went there for the first time, I interviewed about six or seven guys, and I said, "Why are you doing this? Why are you part of this project?" Because apparently they showed the movie to the entire inmate population. It was mandatory, and I think there's just over 100 guys there. And when they said these guys are going to come and they're going to make music, who's interested? One hand went up after a little while, because there's a lot of, you know, bravado and, you know, who's going to make sing songs with the elderly. You know, there's sort of a culture in there that, you know, you might get frowned upon. So the guys who ended up coming, I think we had about 15 to start, and the inmates all talked about their desire to overcome their fears, that they all struggle with anxieties, mm-hmm. and
they have different disabilities.
And public speaking, and mm-hmm. some are, you know, performers or rappers or singers, but they're just so nervous. But a lot of it was about them working on their own fear. I interviewed these guys separately in a closed room, individually, and they all said that.
Hmm.
It was really interesting. So to see these guys to go from, when we first got there, they were really timid. I mean, they were timid. They wouldn't even want to vocalize or come up and stand up and do a solo. To 6 months later doing this concert at the outdoor kind of grassy area in the middle of the prison, and seeing them get up there really scared. I mean, these guys are scared. Because all their co-inmates were there sitting watching. And it was their moment of truth, really, you know? So I was like talking along and calming them down and telling them, you know, it doesn't matter what happens, just, you know, be in the moment. You know, it's okay to be terrified, you know? And they got up there, and they just, they sang every song better, the best that they had ever done. I mean, they really rose to the occasion.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so beautiful, because after this one medley of three songs, the entire inmate population just gave a standing ovation. And it was art. I mean, it wasn't like, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it was beautiful.
I was just gonna say.
And then a week later, we decided to open the program up to whoever wanted to come again. And 60 guys walked in.
Wow.
We had 12 for about 6 months, and now we had about, you know, 30. So it's whittling back down to who's really committed. But to see, you know, more than half the EMA population showed up to join after they saw their people they know, what how they had transformed themselves.
So I saw you got good local coverage of that. Did you get any wider coverage?
Not yet. We've hired a film crew to film both the Academy show, where we had 5 inmates on furlough perform with us for the last 6 songs. We had a large prison contingent there. We must have had their families. They invited all their families and kids, the inmates. And the prison had about 10, 15 people there, workers, and the sheriff was there. And the assistant sheriff. And so we filmed that, and we also filmed the prison show. And we are going to continue filming stuff. We feel like this is our next big project as a sort of follow-up. But it takes a lot of money to put together a film, hundreds of thousands of dollars. You know, the last film was bankrolled by someone else.
Brian Foote took over.
At the Arts Council.
Right. And I remember when he was running that department and then left, I mean, the city was associated with them.
It was a loose affiliation. I mean, there was no formal affiliation. The only affiliation was really Bob. It was Bob because he was the head of the Arts Council and
right.
head of Young at Heart. And the mayor at the time was very supportive. I can't remember her name.
Mary Claire Higgins.
She was very supportive, and I think the mayor before that was very supportive.
Mary Ford.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I don't know the exact history of how the city's been involved with Young at Heart, but we had some informal and formal support that we don't have now. We have a lot of support from the town in terms of the businesses. The businesses support us a lot. And the mayor is kind enough. He always buys an ad, and he's, you know, if we ever ask him for something, I'm sure he would give it to us.
So how do we actually have the city come in and help like they used to when Bob Gilman was the director of the Arts Center over here? So how do we get this connection back when we have 2 previous mayors who were very, very supportive? How do we get this connection back?
Just sit down in a room.
Because I'm hearing this about other agencies who the same thing has happened.
I mean, you know.
How do we get it back?
Young at Heart, and people know this, but for some reason people think that Young at Heart is like this because of the movie, I think. Because of our sort of international profile, they think, oh, they're taken care of. They don't need help. They're fine. But that's not true. I mean,
I think you're
it's
right
really
about
not true.
That.
We scrape by. I mean, we're financially solvent, thanks to the movie. But it's not like it's a never-ending supply. And I'm a half-time worker. I always work half-time. And the salary is
terrible.
It's not terrible, but it's not what you make out in the corporate world, or you know,
right.
It's a non-profit wage.
But you like it.
I love it, so I'm willing to sacrifice that. But, you know, at a certain point, you shouldn't have to. Especially when, you know, what Young at Heart provides to the world as an example of aging. I mean, we're a bellwether. We get emails from all over the world, from institutions, colleges, universities, medical schools who show the film or talk about our paradigm. This one woman won like a multi-million dollar grant basing her study on us. And she got all this money from you know, I don't know who she got it from, but and there are thousands of singing groups that have sprouted up all over the world based on Young at Heart. And, you know, we do get a lot of business support in this town, but it could be different. Could be different.
How do we make it different?
You know, if it was a priority of the people who run the town, they could sit down with us, Bob, me, and them. Let's sit down in a room and say, yeah, are you really committed to supporting Young at Heart? Let's talk about it.
I know you can't see the clock, so I just wanted to
right, okay. 30. All right, so is there any questions you guys have or want to ask before I go?
Yeah, I'm wondering if you applied for private monies, foundation.
education grants, things like that?
We do. We've gotten heavy into that because we have time now. When we were touring a lot, it was just all of our energy was going into putting these tours together. But since that's died down, we have dramatically increased our grant applications and our successful grants. We have a good success rate. It's a lot of time and energy, and it's just Bob and I writing those grants.
And what kind of, do you tend to go for kind of arts-based? Are you doing kind of aging-based? I mean, what's the focus? What are you looking for in the grant world?
Initially, before we started the Prison Project, we wrote a grant for kind of touring, which had been successful in the past with the NEA, for instance. That was our biggest grant giver, and it didn't work this time. We didn't get it. We did write a successful NEA grant for the intergenerational mashup, which we do with the children. And then the prison, once the Prison Project became a reality and we wanted to do it, that's been very successful. That's why we really enjoy the project, and it's also been successful in terms of generating money. So the foundations, the Massachusetts Cultural Council, is always giving us money.
Mm-hmm. They're very private foundations beyond that, though.
Private foundations, we do. We get support from the Beveridge Foundation, from the the Janie Fund has supported the there in the Boston area. The Grace Richardson Trust is also in the Boston area. I'm drawing a blank on the other one. They support us a bit, you know. Other foundations. We are in the midst of having meetings with two women who have been very, very successful at raising hundreds of millions of dollars. And we are in the midst of kind of stepping up our game, because I think with what we have done and who we are, we could be raising a lot more money, mm-hmm. but we just haven't played at that level yet.
Right.
So we're meeting with them, and we're going to actually engage them in a series of kind of formal meetings to look at our kind of immediate and 5-year, 10-year plan to get us into those kind of places.
I was asking partly because I was thinking that there are so many angles from which, you know, so many different framings
right.
that you can use.
Right.
And there are so many, you know, niches that different the foundation world has.
Right.
So from anything from, you know, I would imagine kind of public health to arts, you know, is all kind of fair game if you do the framing correctly. So I was just curious about that. And I'd also like to just suggest that, I mean, it sounds like you have some experts that you're going to be working with, but I would be really happy to have a conversation with you and Bob at any point, because I work in development and grant writing and things like that, and know the foundation world pretty well.
Great.
Just to kind of talk about what some of those framings could be and where those little hidden niches might be to look for funding.
That would be great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Alyssa, do you think it would be a good idea also for him and Bob to sit down and
Why don't we talk about that afterwards?
Yeah.
I'm not sure that we need to process that right here.
Well, thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead. Keep going.
Was there anything else, you guys? Any other?
No, and I really want to thank you for coming.
My pleasure.
I actually
nice.
Have one quick
yes.
question still. So do you guys have a relationship at this point with the budding Center for the Arts, and is there a possibility of being housed there at some point, working with them on some of the placemaking grants that they're working on? Just there's so much ferment there. I'm just wondering if it...
Bob is on the board of the, he was on the board of the Arts Trust.
Arts Trust, yeah.
And he's very close to Penny.
Yeah.
They've been close for many, many
yeah.
years. So he's involved in what they're doing there. I think, you know, for Young at Heart, it made sense for us to, because we have a very specific mission,
right.
I think it made sense for us to have our mission and to go for our mission. So we don't have sort of a formal
right.
relationship with any other organization.
Okay. I was just was just wondering if it could leverage each of you kind of different worlds.
The timing was funny because when we were leaving Memorial Hall, we needed a space right away. Mm-hmm. So we had to find a space. We couldn't wait for, you know, the building that they ended up buying. So we found a really nice space in Florence, which is good. Mm-hmm. But Young Hearts done like 30 benefits for the Center for the Arts over the years, you know, with the first night. So
we
there's definitely a long relationship there.
Where's your office in Florence?
It's at 30 North Maple Street, Bill Arnold's building.
Okay, yeah.
Next to where Artifacts used to be.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank
I
you.
Think we all really, you know, I think we appreciate what a gem the chorus is in Northampton. And so thank you for
sure.
all the work.
Sure. Joy.
Yes, thank
nice
you.
Nice to meet you all.
Appreciate it.
Thanks for coming.
Sure. Take
thank
care.
You.
What time is our next?
5? Mm-hmm.
I
did the minutes already.
Goodbye.
Bye. Bye.
Alyssa, maybe I should give you a card so you have our my
yeah,
information.
Sure. If you want to.
Ooh, well,
that
yeah,
would be super.
My notebook too. So.
And
oh, okay.
The ordinance committee has a meeting at 6 o'clock,
yeah.
So you've got to be out of here.
Let's do that.
Thank you. You too.
Just seems like there's such massive potential for that organization.
Right. Yeah, I think you're right. But they're
just harnessing it and
glad that all the excitement after the movie has died down. I mean, but it was, you know, Bob chose to leave the Arts Council, right?
Yeah.
And kind of to do that full time. So that it was just sort of this interesting thing that he did both, and so there was this automatic tie to the city.
Yeah.
But, it's,
but it just seems like we're hearing the same thing about previous mayors working with them, and I'm talking about privately, and I'm getting confused with it all because I never knew that there was such a problem, and I'm concerned of how do we get it back?
It's my feeling that that's not something we necessarily want to talk about.
Well,
you know,
are we gonna
if
talk
you guys
to
feel it? Differently, I'm happy to do it, but.
Right, who are we gonna do it with? Make an appointment?
You could make an appointment with the mayor if you want to talk to him about it.
You don't want to talk to him?
I'm not sure that as a committee I'd want to do that, I mean.
Yeah, okay, privately. Personally, I mean,
I don't know. I mean, again, I feel like we're on camera
because
here. I don't want to make commitments.
I understand that. But, you know, in arts, we're bringing in people and we're trying to get them to work with us. And it feels like my hands have become tied because what can we do?
Well, we're also only hearing one side of the story.
Yeah.
And these are all situations where things sort of outside. So, where there have been other forces that have had an impact on part of the relationship. So it's not, you know, I don't think it's a simple
mm-hmm.
sort of, you know, thing. I think it's a multifactorial sort
yeah.
of situation.
Thank you. Well, that's it. So what I'd like to do, because at 6 o'clock is ordinance committee meeting,
mm-hmm.
so we gotta be out of here, is to bring up on our schedule for our agenda, I would like to talk about, which is number 8, speak about the agenda for the month of July.
Okay.
And I have, which I think is gonna be really good, is Deborah Anthony, the executive director of Academy Music, coming in, and with her will be Tom Douglas, He's an architect, and he will talk about the capital improvement parts of it also. Mm-hmm. And Terry Masterson, our Northampton economic developer, which he will talk about. And I think he's on the theater board member too, and he'll talk about the economic impact with the Academy of Music. Then I have Jane Banks coming in, the director of the Homeless Service Center for Human Development, and Nancy Gonzalez, who also is the program director of Grace House. And for past 2 years, we've tried to get Grace House in here, and it was canceled. If not, they wouldn't show up. So this time, Peg talked with Jane Banks, and we got them booked. That's it.
So I just want to give you a quick update about October. We talked about the two agriculture-related things. I haven't contacted them yet, but I think there's plenty of time, but I will do it this week.
Because it's on our schedule.
So August, we don't meet, right?
Yeah, we got time off.
And September, we're all set for as well, right?
Yes. And wondering, possibly, maybe Gina Louisa could help us out to get some art in here for the month of November.
And so were you going to talk to Una and Ben about the Tuesday market, or was there someone else you wanted to talk to?
And
CISA
folks.
Yeah.
Well, I see them almost daily, so
if you
want me to.
If you would like to take it over, I'd be more than happy to.
And not the CISA folks, but the Una and Ben.
Yeah. Sure, okay.
So would you like to take that over?
What kind of contact? Town Farm.
So why don't we say that Town Farm would be the first shift, the earlier shift, and I'll work at bringing somebody for 5 o'clock.
Okay, I'll see if 5 would be better for them. Is that
okay? Oh yeah, just let me know as soon as you know.
Would that be for CISA, you mean?
Yeah.
So it's October.
And Tuesday market would come in after
that's 4. Town Farm.
Yeah, okay.
Well, we don't know the timing yet, but yeah.
That sounds good. Well, we're definitely going to need something for November. I'm trying to get as many arts. How about recreation? We've already had Anne-Marie Mosho in here already. Do you want updates from her or?
No.
No, that's what I mean. So who else are we going to get? I mean, they've had this problem before on a committee, trying to get recreation, trying to get arts. And I think we've done pretty,
I don't feel the need that pretty well. Yeah, I feel like we hear from lots of people. I don't feel like we need to every month have people come.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like we have pretty good coverage and people are extremely busy, particularly that time of the year. They're very busy.
I agree. And we've still got some agencies on the outside to bring in. Peg and I were talking, so I need to look at that. So that's about it. So we've got some time. Hopefully Bo will be coming in earlier.
Is Pam coming? I saw her briefly because she gave me the minutes. She often doesn't come till when? What time?
Did you get them on your computer?
I got the minutes.
I asked her if she would start sending them earlier for us so we have them to look at them, like on a Friday.
Did you approve them before I got here?
Yeah. Got that out of the way. In the month of December, because it's right around the holidays,
mm-hmm.
I'd like to make that short meeting. Very short.
Yeah, that'll be the last month of this term of council anyway, so it would be okay if we skip that month.
Skip it. Sounds like a plan to me.
All right.
Good. Because we all get busy for the holidays.
You know, there's some children's theater folks around the city that I wonder if any of them, do you know any of those folks?
Do you mean like Heidi Haas?
No, there's the, Heidi is somebody that, you know, it's a private organization though, so I'm not sure that's, you know, it's her own little kind of business, but there's there are two women that do, I think twice a year, they do productions with kids. And I'm not sure what rubric it's under, if it's under the rec department or schools, but our good friends' kids are in their productions all the time, so I can ask them about that.
For what month would that be, October?
November. I think we're set for October with the agricultural stuff.
Yeah, and I'll get in agencies to come in, so. Yeah, that sounds wonderful. I mean, look at Hope Children. I mean, they're unbelievable.
They are.
That's another one, but it's on. But I think the visibility is good.
Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
Oh, good, coming in early.
How are you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good.
Have a seat.
Is there a bathroom here?
There is, it might be locked that we heard. It's right, check that door right there.
Yeah.
If it's locked, you can always use the women's room, which I think is open and we won't tell anybody, or there's a bathroom in City Hall.
Yeah.
We'll watch it, make sure nobody goes in.
Yeah, totally.
I don't know why they don't go lock it.
Why is the women's room open? Is that because all the council staff is kept in the room?
I often have to go and ask them in the parking office to unlock it, so it's often, the women's room doesn't open either a lot of them.
For some reason, that's open, but yeah, the men's room isn't open.
I just saw a couple people use it from the.
Yeah, I think there are people who, I think they brought their keys.
Oh.
I think they were coming to my keys. Hi.
Hi. So we'll be getting out of here today.
Hello.
Welcome.
Hi.
Hi. Just grab a seat in the front there. But you're also going to be talking, there's a camera and you'll be videoed also.
I'm sure you guys have been on NCTV.
Which
before.
Everybody will see. Is Bo out in the parking lot?
Yeah, I saw her drive by us, so she should be here for parking.
I don't know.
I had to suffer 1 hour parking. I'm gonna have 12 minutes where you get a parking ticket.
We have what, 10 of this coming?
14 people here?
We did.
10 people.
Next year, 15?
14 seems like a lot. Banking on gate wearing athletic shorts. No, wearing a corduroy. Obviously, but.
No way.
Why? They were all black.
I'm not gonna be here at all.
You're not here on Thursday?
Doesn't it go to the?
Tonight. Isn't it going tonight?
Wait, what are you?
The appointment.
Well, no, because the decision hasn't been yet.
It's being announced tomorrow.
Yeah, so it can't go.
Yeah.
I think it's coming to city council July.
We're not referring it on Thursday?
I have 15, so yeah.
I was hoping.
It's not.
Wait, isn't it gonna be here tomorrow?
No, for a while.
I was hoping, because I leave till last night.
You guys, where are we going about this time?
Yeah, that's my car.
Close.
Yeah.
Close, breaks.
I.
I don't know. I have to eat this, I have to breakfast.
I don't wanna do this, because you're driving all the rest of the time.
Because it hasn't been announced. Hi, guys.
No, tomorrow. He's announcing tomorrow.
Forget it. Hey, look, there's a huge crowd. I really have one need.
Well, I had to park in a 1 hour parking spot.
So that's, right? So are you okay with your parking situation?
Is that a table?
No.
Okay.
Yes, I'm fine.
How many more of them?
I have 12 minutes.
Oh, you got eight right now?
We have a couple more.
I thought I just saw one go.
Oh my, I just drove down Whittier Street and saw that house. I know the people who lived in that house.
Awful.
That's a moving violation.
I was there last night.
Oh, God, that was horrible. It's horrible.
I did have a moving violation.
Oh, my God.
Awful.
What?
Last year, jail, for 6 months.
So you, are you meeting right now? Are you waiting for us to do our thing?
Well, wait, you're still early. It's okay. I think you got, I just saw somebody else walking.
When she comes in, we'll start, this will be the most fun you'll ever have all week.
I doubt.
We don't doubt it.
Get ready.
We have what, nine of yous right now?
Yeah. Well, we are waiting for one panel lady.
So we got one more.
Yeah.
Probably having a problem looking for parking, too.
Yeah, parking's tricky, though. I parked down there.
Hi, guys. Good to see you.
Here she comes. She might be lost.
Oh, maybe she's.
Jasper, did you see me?
I saw Jasper. I almost saw him.
I tried to yell at you.
I almost saw him.
So when he honked and said hi to me on my way down there, couldn't keep track of all people who were just.
I just said hi to him, just saw you. I didn't want to distract you. You looked pretty concentrated across the street.
Yeah, I was like a rush.
She like ran across the street, like, felt me in her run.
There she is.
What we gave before, huh?
That's everybody. All right, so I'm gonna start. Oh, I'll walk you through it. Don't worry, I'm gonna walk.
Hey, Bo, I'm gonna have you come right up here.
Yeah.
And you can sit in the chair. And I want to thank the Northampton Towns for being here. I want to thank Bo Playhigh, who's the Director of Choral Activities at Northampton High School. I'd like to introduce you to Gina Louise Shearer, City Councilor from Ward 4, and also City Councilor Alyssa Klein from Ward 7, who also is on this committee, and I'm City Councilor Marianne LaBarge from Ward 6 and the chair. I am very honored to have the students of Northampton Towns being here. I mean, there's not a great audience, very seldom, except for we have something like the benches and hearings going on, but this is an honor. You are being videoed, so it will be on NCTV. And what I'd like to do, Bo, is recognize each one of the students that are here. And if we could start with the young man on the right-hand side and just let him stand up and get his name and so forth, and we'll work our way.
My name is John DeBarlow. Is that it?
What year are you?
I'm a rising senior at high school.
I'm David Plotkin, also rising senior. Junior.
Thank you.
I'm Nathaniel Jones. I'm also a rising senior.
Jasper Price Slade. I am a rising sophomore.
Alexis Farrington. I'm also a rising senior. I'm Jordan Kaur. I'm a rising junior.
Gabriel Felman Schwartz, rising senior.
Luke Haas, rising junior.
I'm Ursa Heidegger, I'm a rising senior.
I'm Emily Woodland, I'm a rising junior.
Thank you for being here.
I want to know at what point in the year you get to say you're rising the next year as opposed to like what you are currently.
Because you've been out of school.
After the
usually after graduation.
Oh, really? Oh, really? Is that like a real technical?
I would like to begin giving you a very, very brief history of how we ended up here, sitting here before you today. And thanks for, first of all, being interested in wanting to understand how it all happened. And so this is a scary opening remark, but 25 years ago, before these kids were born, 25 years ago, I was teaching in the town. I got my master's at Smith in music, and I had a studio on Green Street. And I was teaching privately. I had voice students, piano students, theory composition students, targeted Smith College mostly, a lot of Smith students. That's why I was in Green Street. Local professionals studied with me, and Northampton High School students. And there was such a demand, I ended up having five teachers, and that studio was hopping like a factory, 24/7. But as I worked with the high school students, I noted that their number one complaint was they said there's no music, there's no singing. There was a great band at that point. And there was just a teeny-weeny chorus that the band director did on the side. And that was how they kind of had it for years. You know, they had one position as a band director. And during the renovation, I don't know if you noted that they built a huge band room. No chorus room, because there wasn't a chorus. It didn't exist. It just wasn't a priority, which was fine. It was great for my business. I was doing really well. Years went on. I did that for about 10 years. Had children of my own. Started to really notice the school system then. And I just thought, gee, gosh, if I could get in there, get my hands on that high school, I will try to build something, you know, and do that. That would be my good deed for our town. And then leave, you know, go back to my private studio, which I really did love. So 15 years ago, now we're jumping ahead a decade, 15 years ago, the opportunity presented itself. The then existing band director couldn't take it anymore and didn't enjoy doing his chorus, and shed the chorus, and I saw an ad in the paper for that one position. So it was teaching one class, a 33-person position, and I applied and got it. And thought, oh, this will be cool. You know, I'll go in every day and teach this one chorus, keep my studio going. So I walked in, chorus was at 7:30 in the morning, and there were 17 kids in it. And it was all those sort of difficult kids they threw into this one thing called chorus. And so I went in, and it was pretty early in the morning, and I had a baby at that point. About 15 years ago, I had a new baby. He's out there sitting with their kids. And my daughter was, 5 years old at that
point, so it was rough getting there at 7:30 in the morning. But did it, loved it. The next semester, the chorus doubled. So it went from 17 kids to like 35. And then for the next year, when kids signed up for chorus, it doubled again. And there were 60 kids signed up for chorus for the next year. So there was a need. The kids wanted to sing. As a result, the then principal, her name was Diane Stone, I've seen a lot of principals in 50 years, she made my position, she doubled my position, so I was then two-thirds, which I've stayed for the past like 14 years. This year they made me 83%, so I was up a little bit more. But on this part-time position, we were able to create a choral program. So the third year in, we created levels in different classes for different needs. We had a huge chorus, opened everyone in one. A chamber choir, which did just classical, very difficult music, sort of college level. And that was an audition group of like 30 to 40 kids for next year's group, which is the biggest it should be. And then the Northamptons were born out of all of that. And so today, we have, I added it up just this year, coming through a part-time program, over 180 students singing. Chorus, 75 to 80 kids each semester in chorus. Chamber choir this year had about 35 kids. The Northampton had 15. Over 180 kids. So that's so cool.
That is cool.
And I wish I could, I wanted to bring along 180. But I couldn't, and that's why today you're looking at nine or 10 kids, minus all the seniors that just graduated from the Northamptons. Instead of me talking for 20 minutes, I wanted you to see what we're doing. And sometimes, boy, come to a concert, if you ever want to come in and see the chorus and see everyone singing, every type of kid, it's great. It's a great thing. And it's not me, it's them. And that's what you really need to say.
We put a lot of energy to the talk.
Yeah, which I'm saying. You're pretty. So
but it's a beautiful art.
Yeah.
They do fantastic.
Well, as I say to all the kids in the program, you stand on the shoulders of so many kids. You know, 15 years of the kids and I really kind of trying to build something out of nothing. And we did it. We did it. So you guys know it takes a lot. We don't just like sing, you know, it takes a lot. So that's what we want to show you, what it takes to do this. So there is something.
Okay, question
and,
first.
Yeah.
Do you ever do any fundraising?
Well, I mean, we try to, but a lot of new protocols coming from the superintendent's office around fundraising now.
Yeah, I know.
So that is even tricky
to do.
But we do fundraising. You know, we record a CD every year, this group, and we try to make enough money through the sale of the CD to break even. For the recording bill and the manufacturing bill.
Uh-huh.
When we go on trips and things, we do bake sales and car washes, and that helps with all the little extra things that we do. The chorus goes to New York City every year, and yet this year we brought 110 kids to New York City.
That's fantastic.
So we tried to fundraising for all of that, and So instead of bringing 180, we brought 9, and I'd like that we're going to just open up with a song, and the presentation is through songs. We're going to sing a song, then I'm going to explain what's going on in relation to that. So take it over. Jordan Kerr is the soloist. There she is in the purple. Kind of purple. Is that maroon? I don't know. I'm not great with colors.
I'm just wondering if, because it is being recorded, if we could switch the order. So we would sit back there and they would come forward, and that way the camera will have
the camera's over there in the corner.
So the camera's right there. So
the camera's over there.
So we'll go over there, you guys can go back. Great. You're going to be entertained. Gee, we'll pass the hat after this. The pitch of the group graduated last week. Did you blow an F? Did you blow an F?
No, wait.
There it is.
Every single day, I walk down the street. I hear people say, baby, so sweet. Ever since puberty, everybody stares at me. Boys, girls, I can't help it, baby. So be kind and don't lose your mind. Just remember that I'm your baby. Take me for what I am. Take me, baby, or leave me. A tiger in a cage, you can never see the sun. Could this even need to change, baby? Let's have fun, you are the one I choose. Folks would kill to fill your shoes. You love the limelight too now, baby. So be kind, but don't waste my time. Just remember that I'm your baby.
Studying vocal technique really in depth. And going back to when I taught privately, I had a lot of business people come because they wanted to learn how to use their voice correctly. I had a lot of teachers who were fatigued and their voices were just exhausted.
Right.
And all types of people. And it really goes into physiology and anatomy. So we spent a lot of time studying the voice, how it works, what's going on inside, what's
mm-hmm.
really happening in here. So much crossover into science and anatomy. It's really a crazy thing. And you guys know the difference between like your chest voice versus your head voice, how to sing a high tone, how to resonate in your middle register,
And they're thinking about all this as they're singing. And anyone can sing. Anyone can sing, but it's just learning how. It really, and so there's a lot to it. And they don't just jump up and like, wow,
no,
you know.
Exactly.
Really,
you can tell. It's coming from their heart, from their
movement
of their hands, their body.
They know what they're
fantastic.
Doing.
Fantastic.
And so the next song that we're going to do is going to really demonstrate that. And Lexi Carrington is going to sing the solo. It's an old, Eddie James recorded it. It's called Someday Kind of Love. Is that it? Someday Kind of Love. And just listen to how she uses her voice. She does so many wild things with it. It's really cool. And even in the background, their oohs and ahs are just like, they're beautiful. So, Someday Kind of Love with Lexi.
I loved it, and I'm telling her, you're just absolutely great, and I think you all should get together, do something.
Well,
do something for the Northampton.
We do
every year.
Yeah, we have a CD. Every year we have 15 CDs. We have one from every, or 14 we start the edition.
Make their own band.
Yeah,
I'm just curious, like, in this world today when there are like all these like opportunities, kind of like American Idol and Voice and all these things, how do you think about your futures? I mean, and does that kind of stuff attract you? Does that feel too over-commercialized? I mean, where do you, each of you, some of you intend to go with your singing? What, you know, do you have aspirations directly related to your singing?
I'll start. personally, I definitely want to pursue singing as a career. That's my main goal. And I think just the music industry is just so hard to get into, and trying to find and get all these connections with people is like the main thing that you really need to do. And also, although the shows can be very commercialized at times, I personally actually am this summer auditioning for The Voice on July 19th. So I'm gonna be trying that out, and it'll be a good experience. I don't really have any expectations, but that's kind of the route I'm going on, so we'll see.
A lot of these kids have gone on through the years and gone on and majored in music, or they're all performing. Stephen Weiner, you know. So there's so many. The list is, I could give you, you know, they go on and they are making their livings, or go to, you know, college and graduate school of music. And
that's great.
So Jamie Kent, you've seen him all the time. Right?
Yes.
He was in Northampton, started here.
Oh, really?
He was in Northampton. Oh, yeah. I mean, that's like a local name. But so many, our kids are creative.
Mm-hmm. Very.
Town is creative.
Very proud.
Yeah, I'm very proud too, I've got to say.
You should be.
Do you want to hear another, or do
yes,
you want to?
Sure.
I'm going to preface. I'm going to skip over something and jump ahead to talking about collaboration, which is something we do. Oh my gosh, we do so much collaboration. Probably like city government, learning how to work together, and you know, an important thing. And so I want to do a song now that demonstrates that. So it's learning how to listen to each other. It really is, and really listen through music. And this song is called Helplessly Hoping by Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young. And it really demonstrates, you know, if you watch as they're singing, they're looking at each other, they're listening, they're trying to kind of move together. And when you're new to this group, you just think, oh, you know, you come and you just sing in the beginning. But then after a year, you guys have worked together for a year, you really get it. They really are just, you know, constantly tuning into each other and trying to move together as a team.
You can sing.
So Helplessly Hoping with soloist Matt Jones right there.
They are one person, they are two alone, they are three together, they are four each other. Helplessly hoping her harlequin hovers nearby, awaiting a word, gasping at chances against her chances, wishing he could fly.
Do your thing, but
So many things we work on, but something that's so important is striving for excellence. And we sound terrible so much of the time, don't we? And so, I mean, we really do. We're so hard on ourselves. And we strive for perfection. There's so many, I mean, when we practice together, like, oh, that was terrible. That wasn't it. No, we didn't get it. And we're constantly striving. Like, even that, were you happy with that?
No.
I wasn't either. We were having too many problems. You really were, but because we're just going for the highest possible thing, and you never really get there. Especially in a creative endeavor. You never, but we want to get down on ourselves, but we are striving. We set the bar really high. And so in order to kind of try to reach it, and there are times where we really do, we have to do a lot of creative problem solving. And so we're going to do a song for you now called Put the Gun Down. Ursa,
soloing
on this, and we had to do. We struggled on this one. There was one session, Ursa struggled because the sopranos are singing a note that just goes contrary to what Ursa has to sing. It's so hard to hold your part, and we couldn't figure out how to do it. And so we had, as a group, we kind of came up with a really kind of creative solution that really worked. And I won't tell you what it is. We'll see if you notice anything happening in the song. Hopefully, you don't notice what we did to cover it. But so Ursa Heidinger, put the gun down.
Okay.
That's how I remember.
That's how I remember. Okay. Continue. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Just look at lists and they take out their permanent marker and they don't know
what they're slashing, what they're taking away, what they're,
so. That's true.
But you have to cut something. I understand, but it's very sad, yeah, when it's just, I don't think people get it. And so just wanting to understand, that's huge. No one's ever asked us. No one's ever said, tell us what you do. Tell us what it is. And so.
This is what it's all about. Can you write them
the
hearts?
Oh, yeah, so the problem. Did you know it? Did you see anything?
No, I mean, my mistake would be that you should keep the car and lose the man, but that's just,
I agree, keep the car and lose the man.
Keep the car, lose the man, but no, what, tell me.
Do you want to, Ursa, do you want to
talk? Sure, well, one problem that I specifically was having when we first started was when I got to the court, like, you probably noticed, like, there's one part that it's really low, and then, like, the chorus comes in and it's higher. And I was having a problem like with that transition, like finding the right note sort of to land on. And so Jordan ended up changing her part a little bit so that right before I go to that, she sings my starting note. And then there was another part in the chorus that Emily joins me in because I was having trouble like with that also. Right. And so now I don't need it as much because I've done it so many times. But still nice to have sometimes.
Really great
to
Have any of you taken like dancing lessons? Because I noticed your movements. Because I took dancing lessons all my life since I was 5 years old.
Yeah.
Up until 27.
Wow.
And movement I watch very, very carefully. And have you taken lessons?
Oh yeah, I've been a competitive dancer for 13 years.
I picked it right up. Just the movement.
I'm wondering if you guys can also just talk about what it's given you to be in the Northamptons and what how it feels to be part of the group. And I'm also just curious about another thing, and that is, like, what status does it confer upon you in the high school or take away from you? I mean, what kind of is the placement of a group like yours kind of socially in the high school? So there's a couple questions all in there, but I'm wondering, you know, whatever want to answer, I'd love to hear.
Well, as far as for like what the group has given to me, at least I'm sure other people in the group and people who have come through it, is it really gives you an opportunity to perform in front of other people, and that has been something that I've always kind of wanted to do and something that sort of scared me, but doing it in a group makes it more comfortable, even though that's, I always feel very nervous going, especially for things like first night or singing in front of a few thousand people. That's still scary, but I think it's given me like a lot more confidence in front of other people, and like, I don't know, just my stage presence. It's still not like wonderful or anything, but it, I think it has improved a lot since this was my first year in the group. And so I think that has gotten a lot better, and it's given me that I don't think you can get out of very many other high school classes, so I don't know.
And as for the status thing, it's not really, there are different levels of the program, but that doesn't really change the relationship between the students. Like, NHS is a really nice environment, and everyone's kind of on the same plane, and it's really the chorus and the chamber choir and everyone, we get along really well, and yeah,
you can tell, you take care of each other,
yeah.
You can see it.
Do the guys have a chance to do solos much? I know that you did a kind of brief one, but is it much more kind of the women that get to do solos?
Well, just like this year, it was, well, I mean, we just wanted to highlight all the girls' incredible voices because they really shine this year. But in past years, it's been like, and also we had a senior this year who had a solo, but he's not here today, a guy. And so, I don't know, so it's just like, we just got blessed with the opportunity to have four incredible voices, so we wanted to highlight them as much as possible.
Luke does a song too.
We have a few guys who does, but
it also really depends on the song. Like, we sort of pick the song from the beginning, and then it's kind of just whoever's voice sounds like great, whoever's voice just like, or their personality just like makes the song, basically. That's who we think really should.
How are decisions made about what songs you sing?
What happens is over the summer when we're doing like very few rehearsals, or towards the end of the summer we meet, and during the summer we usually come up with ideas on our own of songs we'd like to sing, and then we listen to them all together
and we kind of have a democratic system of, we like this song, this song might work, but not really, and then this song's like not right for us. And so every year it's a, we generate our own. Bo generates a few for us because she knows it'll sound good with the group we have. So.
How many songs do you learn a year?
Like 10-ish.
This year we had like including, this 12, I feel like.
Including Star Spangled Banner.
10 plus. Yeah.
Yeah,
we also learned Bohemian Rhapsody.
Often they get to arrange the songs. That's, this is a very new group this year, but as they get more experienced in years past, the kids start. I arranged all the songs this year, I did. But lots of times kids step forward and do the arrangements, and that becomes sort of part of the class, how to arrange. Yeah, I think Luke's going to do some arranging next year. He's already starting and maybe some of you guys.
And how many are leaving this year?
Well, they're gone.
This is next year's
group, and we're adding how many more? There are 9 guys in the group next year, so we're adding 5 people. So there are 9 boys and 6 women in next year's group. Yeah.
Do any of you do other musical things, or like, are any of you in kind of like rock bands or other kinds of singing groups?
Yeah,
or anything
David
like that?
Hawkins. I've been playing guitar for like 9-ish years. I have a band of my own. This has actually really helped translate into that. I know things like building my ear, because like on guitar,
yeah,
I can play a bunch of stuff, but this has helped more like for the musically, for it to click. So that's like also translated into like my soloing and various other aspects.
Great. I have another question. Do any of you come from musical families, like with parents that do some kind of music, or?
Well, me personally, my mom was a singer, and she did a lot of performances and was a soloist and went around and sang in like many different venues. And then my stepdad is still in a band and has been in a band for since he was in high school, and is a musician and can play pretty much anything and sings. And also their best friends are the famous band Mountain Wayne, the lead singer. And that band is like my stepdad's best friend, so he's been kind of in my life for a while, so it's a lot of music.
Me? Oh, well, my dad played in a lot of bands. He did the whole, college rock band, high school, and then a little post-college. He went to Manus College of Music and studied there. For a while, and then he eventually stopped playing the band. He got some illness. It made him kind of follow the band, but he still does a lot of music on his own. And we both record privately with the same person, who's sort of a local musician around here. I don't know if you do you know like the Lonesome Brothers or
mm-hmm.
do you know Jim Armenti? We record with him a lot, and so I don't know. We're sort of looking. The local music scene is sort of where I'm at. My mom was never really musical, but she's an artist, and she did dancing for most of her life, and my sister's an artist too, so partially musical, but generally a pretty artistic family is what I come from.
It's amazing, you can tell the way people stand, the way they move their legs, you can tell that they take dancing.
Yeah, I'm not a very good dancer, but my mom, my sister was. I quit early. I wish I'd stuck with it. I'd look like Lexi, maybe, but I don't anymore.
Yeah, there you go.
There are other people that want
to.
Yeah, anybody else?
My dad's side is like tone deaf and they can't do anything with music. But on my mom's side, if you know the movie Fame, that's where my mom went to high school. So that side of the family is very musically inclined. And she was an incredible dancer before she got scoliosis and kind of reared her back. But, that side is.
Anybody else?
My brother was in a group before.
I went to a very musical school. My family isn't particularly musical. Ned actually went there to Hilltown Cooperative Charter Public School. So, yeah, that was kind of my musical foundation, I guess.
Very talented family.
Do any of you come from a family that you would say is completely like not musical?
My dad kind of sang in high school, but that was it. It was like, he didn't pursue anything else after that.
Interesting. I'm just kind of curious about how, you know, if it's something that kind of you grow up with and you're just kind of manifesting it, or if it kind of, you know, is something that's just really internal that you, you know, like a passion that comes from kind of just within. So that's why I was asking, just trying to identify some of those roots of your singing.
Yeah, I feel like it kind of depends. Like, some kids who are really good at math happen to have parents who like teach math at Smith College, and like kids who are, so I feel like a lot of interest do come from your parents. I know that my music probably wouldn't have been fostered if my parents hadn't signed me up for like piano, guitar when I was really young and stuff like that. So I think it definitely does come from your parents, but obviously we have people in the group who don't consider their families to be very musical, so if you have it, obviously you can do it by yourself too, but I think it helps a lot to have a family that is already interested in it.
Oh, should we do one more before
All right, one more. So the last thing, the most important thing we do. Yeah, we learn our technique and we know chords and scales and all this stuff. But I think the most important thing that this does is it brings joy.
Oh, definitely.
It just brings joy. Right? You know, and we're hard on ourselves, I know, but we, oh God, the joy it brings when we sing together. And you just get, when you're all connected and it's just like perfect and awesome, and it's just a feeling, you just die right at that point and just float away. It's just the greatest. You don't want it to ever end, that feeling. And that's,
you know,
what
before you guys got here, we had the manager of Young at Heart, and he was saying that that the elderly folks that are in Young at Heart, like, it's for them, it's like just incredibly life sustaining.
Yeah.
It brings them so much joy to sing. And he was talking about the fact that there's now research that shows that singing is like this incredible life-giving force that keeps people healthier longer and happier longer and all that. So
I think so.
Yeah.
I mean, you really, it's visceral. You feel it. When you're really doing it, it's just visceral. And so I think for chorus, for chamber choir, for all of those 180 kids who are singing every day, it brings them something. I don't know what it is. It's some powerful thing. You can't put your finger on it. And we all feel it. Every group, we all feel it. That's what we're ultimately striving for. That's what we're striving for. It's in it, that's it. So if we don't get there, we've lost it. If we know our music theory and know how to use our voice, but we don't have the joy, forget it. Why do it? So that's probably the biggest thing. And so we're going to end with a song, not a very joyful song.
The River is called. And we're always going to be there for you, West Counselor.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah. Thanks so much. But Bottom of the River, and have a great time. Last time we'll ever probably sing it. We're doing all the music starting after this. Yeah.
Hold my hand. Ooh, baby, it's a long way down to the bottom of the river. Hold my hand. Ooh, baby, it's a long way down, a long way down. If you get sleep or if you get numb,
cop's gonna call in the morning, baby.
And check the cupboard for your daddy's gun.
Red sun rises like an early warning.
The Lord's gonna come for your firstborn son.
Hair's on fire and his heart is burning.
So go to the river where the water runs.
Wash him deep where the tides are turning.
And if you fall, and if you fall,
hold my hand.
Oh baby, it's a long way down to the river.
Oh, baby, it's a long way.
Yeah, we have another year. They're keeping us another year.
Yeah.
That's good.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Okay.
She's doing well.
Yeah,
thanks.
Great.
Thanks.
So lucky to have you.
I know. I keep my neighbor, and I don't even hear her singing at her house.
Oh, I'm singing what though? Oh boy! Thanks, you guys.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Scared to see you.
I was at that fire last night.
Oh dear. Well, now I know the family. I didn't. My kids went to school with both of the kids. Awful. Everything's gone.
Gone. Wiped out. And within 10 minutes.
What happened? Help. Ay, ay, ay. Anyway.
Down now, honey.
Thanks.
I'll talk to you.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Okay. This is it.
Can we bring them to the TPC, Ryan?
Yes.
We should have them at every meeting.
Aren't they awesome?
Amazing. Anything else to do?
That's it.
Move to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.